Supply Network Dynamics, Chapter 6, Part 3, Performance Indicators, Trade-offs. It's not easy getting good performance indicators. They all have their pros and their cons. And to have a bit of a more systematic discussion on this, I use a system dynamics model of a service business, such as, for instance, the business that Interpolis was in. It's an I think model, so why don't I turn to I think anyway? Let's see if that works. No, I think preferably. Okay, here we've got the same model. Now, I can run this, of course, but what does it actually do? Well, you've got an amount of work here, orders, and you've got employees who fill the orders. So the orders in, there's a normal value of orders in of 10, but actually there's a nice noise factor on the 10, and also there's a step function in it. Precise function is that after three time periods, there will be step function of 30%. But because there's noise in it, that's difficult to see in the real world. So the underlying trend is after three time periods, 30% more orders, but there's noise, so you can't really see that all that well. Orders coming out depends on how many employees there are. And then there are a number of performance indicators in between. Of course, the employees are increased or decreased depending on the capacity required. This is basically the same model that we looked at in chapter 1. It is the same model, I suppose. Capacity requires depend on how many work there is and when it should be finished. On the basis of that, we hire more employees. So that works, and there are a couple of indicators here, and I've given them different colors. There is the notion you can look, of course, at all the rates. You can look at the stocks, and you can look at performance and performance indicators such as lead time, stock divided by outflow rate, workload, the amount of capacity required divided by the amount of capacity available, capacity utilization, cost per order. And let's have a little look at what those mean. For this, I move to the interface. And this is the first one. Flow rates. Every business has those, collects those, more or less. I have come across many businesses in the last 25 years, but very few that do not know what their order intake is. The pink one, the orders in. And of course, most of them know what the orders out are. Every time I press the run button, you get a different picture, different behavior. What you can see almost every time is after three, four periods, things go up. But there can be a lot of noise in the order in. It's quite a considerable noise, not unrealistic. And the orders out are somewhat smoothed also because those orders are first in a certain backlog. So that's the flow rates. The flow rates, confusing, but really day-to-day business. But very difficult. In this particular example, just a random example, you would think that after three periods, we have a good business, but actually after 7 months things are going down again, and then 9-10 months things are going up. Probably people would see this, think this is a seasonal pattern. We sell a lot in the spring and in the autumn, or it's a cyclical pattern, I don't know. And of course next time around, I said, no, it's not at all. It's pretty stable. And in this run, you don't see any change at all. And these are, again, random numbers. I don't know what I'll see again. Again, I don't see any clear patterns here. Now you see a climb up coming up again. So the underlying structural change of 30% growth is very difficult to distill from these numbers. But these numbers are what people always have. The flow rates. The second one, which is much more truthful, is the stocks. There are two stocks in this model. There's a stock of backlog and a stock of employees. And here you quite clearly see them going up. Is it true every time? Well, here's a very clear picture going up and even going down again. Why is all the backlog going down here? Well, because the order employees have gone up considerably and so they deplete the order backlog, which is the kind of oscillation that we also saw in chapter one, but normally it's rather brief here. See, in most cases, this is a nice example, actually. First, things are going down in the order backlog, nothing happening much, and then they're going up. And we see that, again, we see overall a more stable picture, but a delayed picture. The picture is better because it has less noise, but it's not like after 3 months you already see something happening. This will take you a quarter or so more. A bigger problem is that very few companies have these numbers. I've come across very few companies that know how many employees they have working on something. Sounds strange. They know how much they pay every month and salaries, of course, and how many people they have. But for any specific business, how many people are working on there? I met one director of HRM who said, you cannot count people. And so this is difficult. You need quite a sophisticated business to have a proper accounting of the real hours worked on a project, on a certain business line, etc. Similarly, all the backlog is tracked in some businesses. We saw in chapter 4 on the semiconductor business, that's really the only thing they measure. That then has a problem that you get a very delayed picture of what's actually happening in the business because it accumulates over time. But many companies have a very obscured view of how many orders they really have at this point, especially if you want to distinguish those, for instance, between the good and the bad ones, the long staying. So this requires quite some sophistication in your underlying systems. Well, then what's very popular and part of your standard training if you do something in economics, in the management accounting or an MBA, whatever, is the ratios, the book-to-bill ratio. We talked about that in chapter 4 and 5, a very good early warning signal, but very noisy, as you can see from the pictures here. That's basically the inflow divided by the outflow. And when that's greater than 1, then there's more stuff coming in than going out. When it's lower, then actually your order book is shrinking. The lead time performance is a very, I think, the best proxy that most companies have of evaluating performance. The downside of it is that you can only see when it's longer than a sort of standard period. When you have, for instance, excess capacity, you will not see that in the lead time. The best indicator for me personally is workload. But nobody measures workload because workload is capacity required divided by capacity available. Both of them are theoretical concepts for most companies and they're difficult to handle. Capacity required is the order backlog divided by the target lead time. Well, most companies don't know the order backlog, leave alone that they have a realistic vision of what could be a good target lead time. And the order capacity required is the number of people times their productivity. Well, what is the productivity of our people? These are very difficult numbers, but you see that it's actually a very nice comparison. Well, the scales are not helping us here, but it's a fairly nice comparison between what you would like to have and what you need to have. If you want to get a bigger picture, perhaps I should make workload only between... why not this? And then you get a better picture. And you see that workload initially increases here, and by the extra increase of staff coming in, workload declines again. And that happens again and again and again, depending a bit on the noise where it is in the chapter. But workload is a wonderful indicator, but difficult for people to actually monitor in practice because it's based on some difficult concepts. So forget about it, focus on lead time. Lead time probably in combination with capacity utilization. If lead time tells you quite well how you're doing in the market in a busy time, capacity utilization has the downside that it cannot tell you how much many orders you're missing, but it can tell you if you have overcapacity. Capacity utilization, quite some companies have, although it's not so easy. They have a number, but really, what is 100% capacity? And can you have more than 100% capacity? Usually you can. What does that say then? Yeah, that's 1/3 of our normal capacity. So before you know it, this then gets, with Goodhart's law, this gets corrupted, but it's usually a pretty good indicator. Orders out are something that, and then the value of that, the money value of it, is of course that's even going into your financial system, so that's a good financial indicator. But it's noise, as we said earlier on. The cost per order is a good one. All these things, though, do have some time lags in them that tell us mostly about the decisions that you had to take up here. If you look at this period, remember that in this period, the first period, there was an increase in demand, sort of the second and the third period that's met by an increase in capacity. In the fourth period, you can more or less see that you're able to get more orders out, and the cost per order seems to have gone up somewhat, and there's some overcapacity there. And you can see that more often. Usually there's some overcapacity in the fifth quarter, and there's some higher cost per order there as well, because you've got some overcapacity. At any rate, these are usually delayed, and that's the main downside of those financial indicators. But still, if you have them, and if you have them properly, with this list, you could run pretty much any service business if you'd want to.